starting with Professor Khairala from Monastir, Tunisia, speaking about toxoplasmosis and other parasites. Monsef, please.
Thank you, Carl. Slides, please. Ocular toxoplasmosis is the most common cause of posterior uveitis in all countries around the world. And the retina is the primary site of Toxoplasma gondii infection, with secondary choroidal involvement producing retinochoroidites. So the appropriate term to call toxo is retinochoroidites and not chorioretinitis. Ocular toxoplasmosis can be divided into two types, congenital ocular toxoplasmosis and acquired toxoplasmosis, which is more common than previously suspected. The diagnosis of ocular toxoplasmosis is very easy in typical clinical presentation. However, it may be challenging in atypical cases requiring a high level of clinical suspicion combined with appropriate laboratory investigation. Treatment involves the association of antitoxoplasmic drugs with corticosteroids. Prognosis usually good in immune-competent patient, may be poor in immune-compromised patient. What about the typical clinical presentation? Young patient, otherwise healthy, unilateral involvement, presenting with decreased vision, floaters, redness, or pain, and in children, symptoms may include strabismus, leukocoria, or nystagmus. Fundus examination, as you can see, typically shows the unifocal necrotizing retinochoroidites associated with old pigmented chorioretinal scar adjacent to active lesions or in the affected or in the contralateral eye. The old scars in ocular toxoplasmosis were previously attributed to congenital infections. However, they may be postnatally acquired. It is important to keep in mind this important. In a patient with unifocal retinochoroidites without chorioretinal scar, 25 to 30% of cases, and this clinical presentation without old scars may suggest acquired ocular toxoplasmosis. The findings associated with retinochoroiditis include moderate to severe vitritis, and in case of severe vitritis, you may have the classic headlight appearance. Retinal vasculitis may be focal, diffuse, with vascular sheathing adjacent or to or distant from the active lesions. What we call Kirielis arteriolitis is typical for toxoplasmosis. They may be optic disc edema, and the association of anterior uveitis is not uncommon. Granulomatous anterior uveitis that may be hypertensive in nature. The size of active lesion, variable. Location may be central chorioretinochoroiditis, retinochoroidites adjacent to the optic disc producing neuroretinitis or juxtapapillary retinochoroiditis or peripheral. Atypical clinical presentation. Clinician should be aware of atypical clinical presentation of ocular toxoplasmosis, including bilaterality, multifocal retinochoroiditis, large lesions, they may mimic viral necrotizing retinitis, and risk factors for such atypical clinical presentation include patients with AIDS, advanced age, or patient with other forms of immune suppression. Other atypical clinical presentation of ocular toxoplasmosis include punctate outer retinal toxoplasmosis, optic neuritis without visible lesion, retinochoroidal lesions, intraocular inflammation without visible lesion presenting in the form of anterior uveitis, intermediate uveitis, or retinal vasculitis, is very, very uncommon in toxoplasmosis. Possible, but uncommon. Scleritis, very uncommon. And pay attention to the association of toxo with Fuchs syndrome. Mainly patient with inactive lesion. Inactive lesion with intraocular inflammation caused not by toxo, but by Fuchs uveitis. This is a classic association. Fluorescein angiography, early hypofluorescence and late hyperfluorescence in active lesions. FA is useful for the evaluation of for the activity of retinochoroidites and associated retinal vasculitis and papillitis. Diagnosis of choroidal CNV and the diagnosis of associated occlusive retinal vasculitis. ICG angiography is not necessary in patients with ocular toxoplasmosis. It can show hypofluorescence of active focus at all phases and with the presence of multiple hypofluorescent satellite dark dots in up to 90% of cases. So toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis is a more widespread inflammation than visible fundus lesions. OCT, very important tool, showing hyperreflectivity and irregular thickening in the inner retina at the retinal lesions with shadowing of the outer retinal layer, the presence of hyperreflective dots in the vitreous cavity close to the fundus to the retinal lesion, posterior hyaloid thickening, increase in choroidal thickening, choroidal thickness under the acute inflammatory lesions, better seen by swept source OCT, and diagnosis of serous retinal detachment frequently associated with ocular toxoplasmosis. OCT, important to monitor the course of retinochoroiditis, and you can see after resolution of acute lesions, the development of atrophic changes, loss of retinal tissue, including the outer photoreceptor layers, sometimes a cystic cavitation, distortion of the retinal architecture, and epiretinal membrane as complications of resolved acute retinal toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis. Visual field should be part of clinical assessment of patients with ocular toxoplasmosis, and retinochoroidal scars close to the optic disc are associated with more severe visual field defects. The prognosis of ocular toxoplasmosis is good in most patients with normal immune system. The inflammation gradually resolved in 6 to 8 weeks, and as you can see, a chorioretinal scar replaces the active lesions. However, there are factors associated with poor outcome, including the central location of retinal lesions, extensive lesion, multifocal retinochoroiditis, advanced age, and immune suppression. Complication of ocular toxoplasmosis may include retinal vascular occlusion, mainly branch retinal artery occlusion, serous or erythematogenous retinal detachment, CNV, a late complication of ocular toxoplasmosis, subretinal fibrosis, acute choroidal ischemia, and many other complications involving the macula. The laboratory diagnosis, as I said before, the diagnosis of ocular toxoplasmosis is mainly based on clinical features. However, we need laboratory investigation to confirm the diagnosis, mainly in atypical situation. A positive serologic test does not confirm the diagnosis of ocular toxoplasmosis, as you know, given the high rate of seropositivity in the normal population in most countries. demonstration of or of production of specific antibody or detection of toxoplasma DNA in ocular fluids has high sensitivity and specificity to confirm the diagnosis. When should we perform anterior chamber TAP in patients suspected with ocular toxoplasmosis? No in typical presentation, yes in atypical presentation, in patients with fundus hidden by vitreous opacity, and in immune compromised patients. In all this situation, anterior chamber TAP is needed. Diagnosis can be confirmed by the Whitman-Desmond coefficient or by Western blot technique. PCR is also useful, particularly in atypical presentation in immune compromised patients. In some cases, we can combine both Whitmer-Desmond coefficient and PCR to confirm a diagnosis of ocular toxoplasmosis. Differential diagnosis in patients with congenital toxoplasmosis, as you can see, numerous infectious and non-infectious diseases, and in acquired toxoplasmosis, differential diagnosis mainly include other infectious or non-infectious diseases. What are indications for treatment in ocular toxoplasmosis? There is a consensus to treat patients with toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis if involvement of zone 1, large lesion, marked vitritis, the presence of retinal vascular occlusion in all immune compromised patients, in patients with advanced age, and in acquired toxoplasmosis. Patients with small peripheral retinal lesion, immune competent patients may be either treated or observed. Most treatment regimen consists of a 4 to 8 week course of antibiotics. This is the classic protocol to treat ocular toxoplasmosis associating sulfadiazine, pyrimethamine, and folinic acid. There are other options, including clindamycin, pyrimethamine associated with azithromycin, and Bactrim. Corticosteroids are usually required to control inflammation, must be initiated at least 20 hours after administration of antitoxoplasmic drugs. Never alone. You can see this is a case of toxoplasmic retinochoroiditis treated with corticosteroids alone, and you can see the worsening of the ocular involvement because this patient has been treated with corticosteroids alone. So never steroids alone without associated antitoxoplasmic drug. Treatment to avoid recurrent ocular toxoplasmosis, in some specific situation, we can use a long-term treatment with Bactrim every 2 days to decrease the risk of recurrences in some particular situation, mainly immune-compromised patient and patient at risk for losing vision. Prophylaxis, primary prevention to avoid the infection is very important. Secondary prevention is subject of controversy. Let's move to some other parasites very briefly. As I mentioned before, ocular toxocariasis, the diagnosis of ocular toxocariasis is mainly based on clinical features, the presence of a single retinochoroidal granuloma, typically associated with vitreous traction, and granuloma may involve the posterior pole, the periphery, and some patients may present with a chronic endophthalmitis. Other parasites observed in some area, for example, the diffuse unilateral subacute neuroretinitis. This is a very typical disease seen in parts of US and South America. Onchocerciasis, called the river blindness, endemic in many areas of sub-Saharan Africa. Cysticercosis, encountered in South America, India, Southeast Asia, as you can see, very typical subretinal lesions. The diagnosis should be considered in patients living in or traveling back from a specific endemic area. This is another infectious disease, and you can see here a case of gnathostomasis, and this is most prevalent in Southeast Asia and Latin America. The treatment may be by surgery or laser photocoagulation. Thank you for your attention.